The Leper of Saint Giles by Ellis Peters. 1. Brother Cadfael set out from the gatehouse that Monday afternoon of October in the year 1139, darkly convinced that something ominous would have happened before he re-entered the great court, though he had no reason to suppose that he would be absent more than an hour or so. He was bound only to the hospital of St. Giles, at the far end of the monk's foregate, barely half a mile from Shrewsbury Abbey, and his errand was merely to replenish with oils, lotions, and ointments the medicine cupboard of the hospital. They were heavy on such remedies at St. Giles, even when there were few lepers, for whose control and assistance the hospice existed. There were always some indigent and ailing souls in care there, and the application of Cadfael's herbal remedies soothed and placated the mind as well as the skin. He made this pilgrimage on an average every third week to replace what had been used. These days he made it with all the better will, because Brother Mark, his much-prized and dearly missed assistant in the herbarium, had felt it to be his destiny to go and serve with the unfortunate for a year, and a visit to St. Giles was now a blessed reminder of peaceful days departed. For to make all plain, Cadfael's forebodings had nothing whatever to do with the momentous events soon to be visited upon the Abbey of St. Peter and St. Paul of Shrewsbury. No reference to marrying and giving in marriage, no omens of sudden and violent death. He was expecting, rather, that in his absence some vessel full of precious liquid would be broken, some syrup left to boil over, some pan to burn dry, in his workshop in the herb gardens, or else that his brazier would be fed too generously and set light to the parcels of dried herbs rustling overhead, and in the worst case to the whole workshop. Mark had been gentle, dutiful, and neat-handed. In his place Cadfael had been given, for his sins, the most cheerful, guileless, heedless, and handless of cherubs, eternally hopeful, never chastened, a raw novice of 19, fixed for ever at the age of a happy child of 12. His fingers were all thumbs, but his zest and confidence were absolute. He knew he could do all, his will being so beneficent, and fumbled at the first balk, forever astonished and aghast at the results he produced. To complete the problem he presented, he was the most good-humoured and affectionate soul in the world. Also, less fortunately, the most impervious, since hope was eternal for him. Under reproof, having broken, wrecked, mismanaged, and burned, he rode the tide serenely, penitent, assured of grace, confident of avoiding all repetition of failure. Cadfael liked him, as he was infuriated by him, out of all measure, and gloomily made large allowance for the damage the lad was almost certain to do whenever left to follow instructions unsupervised. Still, he had virtues, besides his sweetness of nature. For rough digging, the chief challenge of autumn, he had no peer. He plunged into it with the vigour others devoted to prayer, and turned the loam with a love and fellow-feeling Cadfael could not but welcome. Only keep him from planting what he dug. Brother Oswin had black fingers. So Brother Cadfael had no thought to spare for the grand wedding which was to take place in the Abbey Church in 2 days' time. He had forgotten all about it, until he noted, along the foregate, how people were gathering in voluble groups outside their houses and casting expectant looks away from town along the London road. The day was cloudy and chill, a faint mist of rain just perceptible in the air, but the matrons of Shrewsbury were not going to be done out of a spectacle on that account. By this road both wedding parties would enter, and word had evidently gone before them that they were already approaching the town. Since they would not actually enter the walls, a good number of the burgesses had come forth to join the people of the foregate parish. The stir and hum were almost worthy of a minor fair day. Even the beggars gathered about the gatehouse had an air of holiday excitement about them. When the baron of an honour scattered over 4 counties arrived to marry the heiress to lands as great as his own, there must be lavish largesse to be hoped for in celebration. Cadfael rounded the corner of the precinct wall by the open green of the horse fair and continued along the high road, where the houses thinned out, and fields and woods began to reach green fingers to touch the rim of the road in between. Here, too, the women's...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.